So I got a check engine light a few minutes after I started driving. After pulling over and reading the error code, this was the result. It seems my EGR valve is starting to act up, even though I only replaced it about 1.5 years ago. After clearing the error code and continuing my trip, it did not happen again, but I'm still going to block the EGR part for now till I can replace the valve, as I'm on a road trip and I don't want to risk losing engine power at a bad moment.
First, a very quick note on what an EGR valve is exactly. EGR stands for exhaust gas recirculation, meaning it will feed exhaust gases of the engine back into the intake of the engine. Why do such a crazy thing? Because it lowers the temperature of the engine, creating less NOx at times when not a lot of power is required. You can also think of it in terms of virtually reducing the cylinder size of the engine, as the place taken up by the exhaust gases can no longer be filled with oxygen, so you get a smaller, less powerful engine. Of course, the huge disadvantage is that these exhaust gases contain soot that sticks everywhere, clogging up the air intakes over time and sticking to the shaft moving the EGR valve, causing it to block. Which is probably what is happening with mine now. And if it locks up in the open position, there is so much exhaust gas coming in all the time in the engine, it is starved for fresh air and does not have any power. Anyway, so far for the background theory. On to the practicalities of blocking the EGR path so the car can keep driving. Since my last EGR adventure, I carry an old gasket and a piece of stainless steel plate in the shape of that gasket with me. I think it's about 1.5 or 2 millimeter thick. I've added the most important dimensions here, so you can use it as a template if you do not have access to a gasket. But in order to make an airtight seal, you will need the second gasket anyway. You can order these separately for a few euros, or if you buy a new EGR valve, usually replacement gaskets are in the package anyway.
However, if you find yourself in a situation where you really only have the one gasket that is already present in the system, I think it is best to place it on the intake side of the engine, as I suspect it is better to have a small leak of exhaust gases than it is to lose pressure at the intake.
Since you cannot see what you are doing when placing the blanking plate, it is best if the plate has the exact matching shape, so you can align the sides of the plate with the EGR valve with your fingers. So I trimmed a bit of excess material from my plate, except for one corner, so I can easily position it. Note that you can also buy these blanking plates ready-made. With that preparation done, time to install it. In order to more easily access the EGR valve, it is best to remove some of the front covers of the car. That takes maybe 15 minutes, but it makes life a lot easier. You do not need to completely remove the big cover, only enough to remove the front top beam.
All the cover screws are Torx 30. And for the top beam, you need 10 mil sockets.
Sometimes you can just wiggle off the air intake hose, but since I have the correct tool to unclip it, I just use that. You can probably also unclip it with normal pliers.
Now we have access to the EGR valve, and this side is the intake side where we need to add the extra gasket and blanking plate. Since there is an extra bracket screwed on top of the screws, there is first a set of nuts that need to be removed with a 10mm socket. After getting that bracket out of the way, you can remove the actual screws with a 13mm socket. It is a bit tricky because of the lack of space with all the tubing hanging in your way, but it is doable. I would suggest to leave one screw partially in, so everything stays more or less aligned and the existing gasket does not fall out. As you can see, my screws are corroded at the top. I use the wire brush to clean them up and put some paint on them. But I need to replace them in time, because if they snap, I'm in a world of trouble. I can't immediately find this type though. Maybe it's easier to weld something together myself. With one screw out and the other loose, you can pull the EGR valve a bit to the back so you can easily insert the extra gasket and blanking plate, and then align the top holes. After fastening the top screw a bit, time to remove the bottom screw and repeat the alignment process for the bottom holes. This is the most difficult part, as you cannot see what you are doing, but it's made much more easier if the blanking plate has the correct shape and you can just align its sides. If all is aligned well, you can insert the bottom screw again. Move the EGR valve itself a bit as well to position it correctly, as there are tubes pulling on it so it gets misaligned. With everything lined up correctly, the hard part is now done and it's just a matter of tightening everything. A quick visual inspection of both screws and the gasket blanking plate gasket sandwich configuration. And then it's a matter of just putting it all back together. Note that I put some grease on the screws to make sure they do not rust and lock up, a matter of making life easy for future me. Now if you block off the EGR part, the car's computer, the ECU, will at times know something's up, because when it opens the valve it expects less intake airflow. That will not happen now with the EGR part blocked. So at times it will complain with the check engine light. If I recall correctly, I had this maybe one or two times in a month of driving like this. But it does not prevent you from driving, and it does not go into the so-called limp mode, at least not on my 2014 Boxer. Still, this is only a temporary solution to keep you driving till you can replace the valve. A car in this condition will likely fail vehicle inspection emission tests and potentially you can get fined. For completeness, a quick demonstration how to undo and reinsert the plastic clips at the bottom of the top front cover. And an overview of the tools needed for the job. A Torx T30, a 30mm long socket, a 10mm normal socket, and some kind of pliers for the hose clamp. That's it, I hope this video was helpful.